Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Catholic Mass here at St. Patrick's Catholic Community in Scottsdale, Arizona. My name is Father Eric Tejas, the pastor of the parish, and we welcome you to this televised Mass. First of all, to our parishioners, we're glad that you're here today, and as you know, the communion is offered 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. on Sunday, and so we hope to see you there. We've had a great response from our people. Those who are searching for a community or looking online for spiritual growth, and those who are viewing our Mass here because you visited here before, know of St. Patrick's, welcome. We're so glad that you're here to come and pray with us today. I also want to give a special welcome to the incarcerated of Maricopa County. From now on, we've been asked to have the Mass available for the facilities on DVD, and to our brothers and sisters and who are incarcerated right now, welcome. We're so glad that you're here with us. I come as your brother to come to preach to you the good news of Jesus Christ for you and to know the dignity and the value that you have to God and his people. And so we're honored that you're here with us joining today. Our gathering song as we prepare now for the 13th Sunday in Ordinary Time. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
During this difficult time in our world, the Scriptures and our church teaching remind us that forgiveness from God comes at any moment. All that is desired is a sincere heart of penance and asking for forgiveness for any sin that we recognize in our lives. And so at this part of the Mass, let's now silently call to mind the sins that we are sorry for, knowing that the Spirit of God is ready to forgive us at any moment. You were sent to heal the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You plead for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins. Bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
On this Sunday celebration, let's join God's people everywhere in the singing of the glory.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Only
Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. As we prepare now for the readings, our first reading from this book of 2 Kings deals with a woman who has hospitality to someone who represents God. The mindset is that someone from God should always be welcome, but that also includes the lowly. In our second reading, Paul's letter to the Romans reminds us of what baptism is, calling us out of darkness into being a new creation. And then in the gospel, Jesus reminds that when the disciples are sent out, that they will receive hospitality as they preach the good news. Let us now be open to the word of God.
A reading from the second book of Kings. One day, Elisha came to Shunem, where there was a woman of influence who urged him to dine with her. Afterward, whenever he passed by, he used to stop there to dine. So she said to her husband, "I know that Elisha is a holy man of God. Since he visits us often, let us arrange a little room on the roof and furnish it for him with a bed, table, chair, and lamp, so that when he comes to us, he can stay there." Sometime later, Elisha arrived and stayed in the room overnight. Later, Elisha asked, "Can something be done for her?" His servant, Gehazi, answered, "Yes, she has no son, and her husband is getting on in years." Elisha said, "Call her." When the woman had been called and stood at the door, Elisha promised, "This time next year, you will be fondling a baby son." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Forever I will sing, forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. Sing the goodness of the Lord. Forever I will sing, forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. Sing the goodness of the Lord. The promise of the Lord I will sing forever. Through all generations my mouth shall proclaim your faithfulness. For you have said my kindness is established forever. In heaven you have confirmed
the Lord, sing the goodness of the Lord. Blessed the people who know the joyful shout, in the light of your countenance, O Lord, they walk. At your name they rejoice, they rejoice all the day, and through your justice they are exalted. Forever I will sing, forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord, sing the goodness of the Lord. You are the splendor, splendor of their strength, and by your favor our horn is exalted. For to the Lord belongs our shield and the Holy One of Israel, our King. Forever I will sing, forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord, sing the goodness of the Lord. Forever I will sing, goodness of the Lord, sing the goodness of the
Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourselves as dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia,
alleluia,
alleluia, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me." Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Whoever receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever receives a righteous man because he is a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives only a cup of cold water to the one of these little ones to drink, because the little one is a disciple. Amen. I say to you, he will surely not lose his reward. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My given official name by my parents is Eric Christopher Tejas. I was going to be known as Ricky, but I guess someone else in the extended family chose Ricky, and so I guess my parents decided just to name me Eric, and that's been my name. But also, when we are given our official name, we're also given other names in our lives, and one of my favorites is nicknames. Always enjoy giving my football players at Sunny Slope a nickname, but it should be always out of love or a good, loving, teasing way of something that really that's endearing to us. When I was in the seminary in college, my nickname was Bear. And they called me Bear, I guess because I liked to eat, because they gave me a shirt that said, "Please don't feed the bear." And then when I went to Mount Angel in Oregon for theology work for 4 years, the movie E.T. came out, and so Eric Tejas became E.T., and that became my nickname. And when we ever get a nickname, it just, you become that person. And sometimes we might even take it with a grain of joy and humor. One of my best friends up in high school was named Gordo. That means fat in Spanish, and that can be an insult, but he loved it, and he wanted to be called Gordo, and all of us would call him that as well. You know, we as Christians also have been given a nickname. We do have our names given to us by our parents, but through our baptism, if we've been baptized or have that desire that maybe one day we'll be baptized, we are given a name given to us by God himself, children of God. Paul would call it children of the light, not of darkness, but of light. And you know, when we were baptized, we were given a white garment. To be clothed with dignity is what the prayers say. In the Bible, whenever a garment is given to another person, it represents a new status. That if a child or an adult or teen is baptized into the Christian faith, no matter what Christian faith that is of denomination, you are a child of God. It's a title given by God. Sometimes we humans don't understand that title does not have an expiration date. Sometimes we think you have to earn that title. Yeah, you should live up to that title. Sometimes we fall short on it, but God never takes that title back. He never says, "You don't deserve it. You're not worthy of it. Oh, you've disappointed me. You've done all these bad things." Because in all honesty, all Christians, no matter how good we think we are or people think we are, we do sin. That's why we begin each Mass asking for forgiveness. No one is a true Christian who says, "I don't need forgiveness." They're not speaking truth. In fact, John in the Scriptures call them liars. They're liars because they're denying what we struggle with. But yet, in giving that title, there is a way to witness. St. Paul tells us in Romans today in the second reading is that we have been given the strength to live that out, to be witnesses, that we're not left alone on our own. That doesn't mean you and I don't have lonely moments, that we're discouraged, that we feel that we're abandoned by others, but that God is always with us. The problem is people who claim to be followers of God will abandon people. Because sometimes we think God withholds his title, that baptism is taken away. It can't be taken away. Even the church would understand that, to say once one is baptized and one can say, I no longer want to be a Christian, it doesn't matter. That's why I always keep reminding you in the theology. We have really poor theology because we're lazy as Catholics, and we won't change it because we've been taught that, and we can't help ourselves, Father, because it just comes out of our mouth, ex-Catholics. That is the most insulting thing we can say. It is the biggest lie. It's a lie. One can choose no longer to be part of the family and can walk away. One can say, I don't believe in the Catholic faith or God or Jesus Christ anymore, but you don't lose that title. You're still that, because at any moment you can come back without having to pay a bunch of money and sign all these papers and do all this stuff. You can come back at any moment when your heart is ready to come back. So how do we, as Christians now, live our faith in the midst of this pandemic? What is it that we respond? And in today's readings, both the Gospel and the Old Testament reminds us our baptism is lived out through showing hospitality. In the ancient Mediterranean world, especially the time of Jesus, it was a given that everyone needed to give hospitality. And no one was approached of saying, oh, you don't deserve it, or you're a bad person. The code was everyone was to be greeted with hospitality. In today's gospel, Jesus reminds the disciples, the apostles, that they're going to go out. And the mindset of the people in that ancient world was that any prophet, any apostle, any follower of Jesus, any low person in status was to be greeted and treated hospitably. And Jesus expands that not just to holy people, not just to people in good standings or great status, but even those who are oppressed, set aside, looked down upon, and just told, you're not important to society anymore because you're not valuable, you're not worthy because you're too sinful or not loved. Jesus models to all the baptized that we must be hospitable. In fact, it is a great offense to God not to give hospitality to any person. Isn't that interesting? Christians think they know the Bible, and yet when someone preaches the truth of the Bible, they don't like it because it disturbs their thing of what they think the Bible says. The Bible should disturb us because sometimes we give poor evidence that we're hospitable. In today's first reading, this woman welcomes a great man from God, one of the prophets there. And she shows hospitality in that way, in greeting people. She reminds us that the most important thing a follower of God can do is to welcome the stranger in the name of the Lord. Let me repeat that. For any follower of God is this, that the most important thing that any of us can do is to welcome the stranger in the name of the Lord. That is what makes you and me, you and I, authentic disciples. I find it interesting, and thank God they're the minority of this part of people saying, we want to get in our buildings. We're all grieving. All of us are. But with the numbers going up, especially here in Arizona, more people have common sense to stay away. And that's why we're wearing masks today as a reminder. And when I give communion out, I'll be wearing a mask as well. We're trying to do what our medical people ask us to do for the state and love of other people as well. But they're so interested to get into buildings, which, by the way, they're not even close to being 25%. Huh? Most people are staying away. But yet they think, the church really, we're not able to live our faith unless we're inside the building receiving Jesus. Well, how about being more hospitable? That's exactly how you live your baptism. You just so narrow it, so limited to say it only counts when we're receiving communion and we're in a church and we're doing churchy stuff. We will get back one day. God, I wish I could tell you when. But we will, because somehow God will lead us through this. I promise you, okay? I think God will. This is only a dot in human history, but we're going through this painful time. But God wants you to be more hospitable. That's how you become an authentic follower of Jesus. And so this week, Who do you and I look down upon? Maybe through race. Maybe it's inherited, but we're blind to it because we just automatically just grew up that way. And we look down at other people. Maybe we look down at people in the economic situation. And maybe we just keep having this mindset that poor people are lazy and they just are leeches to welfare. And if they really weren't poor, they would get up and work like me. Without having that compassion and listening to their story. When the scriptures just said, welcome the stranger, and yet we want to build a wall. We want to keep people away. Doesn't mean we don't have control of who's in our country. It's not for, people always say, well, you're for open borders. No, no one's that. No one in their right mind is. But we have to be able to welcome people, know who's in here, but so that they may continue to contribute things that are important. And yet people who call themselves Christians say, send the strangers back. There's not enough. And yet, that's their version of the Bible, and that's not living our faith. How about someone in our family that we haven't been hospitable towards? Hospitality is more than just saying, come for a cup of coffee. Here's a donut. I'll make you a meal. Hospitality means engaging people where they're at. And to you, our incarcerated brothers and sisters today, you are valuable, and you are important to God. And maybe we need to ask for your forgiveness for the times that we haven't cared about you, for the times we just labeled you as people who don't deserve dignity or worthiness. Probably the most holiest thing that you can do from your places right now is to forgive fellow Christians who are so smug, who think they're so righteous, and just look down upon you and say, you're not worth the dignity. And unfortunately, there are some, but they don't speak on behalf of all, because there are many brothers and sisters who follow Christ, who love you, who value you. And even though we can't visit you right now, thank God for this technology. And I hope that these facilities will keep showing our masses to you, because each week we're going to remind you how much you're important to God. But not just the incarcerated, anyone who's been away. If anyone has ever told you in the church that you are not in good standings, could you forgive the church? Can you forgive us? Because we're not very hospitable. As the Bible teaches today, there is nothing more important for one who follows God than to welcome the stranger in the name of the Lord. The Word of God has been proclaimed to us today at our Mass and broken open by today's homilies. These are some of the ways that followers of Jesus Christ who are on mission to live out our faith. The St. Patrick Youth Programs are digital and are for the summer. So our people, our children, and our youth here, there's so much for you online, which you are very familiar with. We have our elementary youth, the SP Kids video every week to engage your children. Summer with the Saints, Bolt Virtual Bible School. For middle school students, we have the Edge events on Monday, Thursdays, and Fridays online. The Leadership Camp. And for high school students, Life Teen events on Sunday and Wednesday evenings, again online. For more information, just check out the website. Young adults, you are invited this on Wednesday evening for a 30-minute prayer group. Jill Bagshaw will be able to assist you if you can call her at the office, or you can receive the Zoom link for prayer. And parishioners, on our Facebook every weekday at 3 p.m., one of our staff members leads everyone in prayer, and they're getting great views on that. So to lead you in prayer, you can watch it at 3 or later on, so that prayer and devotions are offered during this time. Thank you for your gifts to keep this parish going, in the sense that we're still on mission. The church hasn't closed, and we're not reopening when it's time to get in our building. We're re-entering the building, but not reopening, because we're still open. So call us if you need anything or any directions. Thank you. I ask you now to please stand, because at our baptism, you and I are priestly people. We pray on behalf of everyone on the face of the earth.
for God's holy church. Through practicing radical hospitality, may all people know they are welcome and loved in the sight of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For inspiration, that God will guide legislators and policymakers in developing new structures and procedures for police and law enforcement officials. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those whose jobs and livelihoods call them to risk their health by addressing the coronavirus, and for families, individuals, and the homeless who find it extremely difficult to find safety, may they be cared for and protected by employers, officials, and by God's people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all associated with correctional facilities, inmates, employees, and officers, and family and friends of incarcerated loved ones during the COVID-19 crisis, that talks between clergy and state officials will continue to yield increased protection for all, and that communications from prison and jail officials serve to comfort anxieties for all affected. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are struggling with not being able to gather safely in their religious communities, that we may all see the many ways our faith is lived out in the world while looking forward to that day when we can all gather again in safety. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For young people seeking directions and lives of meaning, and for the teens from our parish who virtually attended the Life Teen Leadership Conference this week, may they be emboldened to take up their crosses and follow the Lord of life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer illness of any type, may the Lord restore their health and give them hope. And for those who have died, particularly those from COVID-19, that the Lord will welcome them into the fullness of life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, not only the petition spoken out loud, but those deep within the hearts of everyone participating in this liturgy. Answer all our prayers according to your compassionate way. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And now we move to the liturgy of the Eucharist, the offertory.
Welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome. All are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome. All belong. Welcome all the broken hearted. All who sorrow and despair, you are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim, all are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace, all are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. All are welcome, all belong.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this our sacrifice, the sacrifice of ourselves, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Amen. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us truly give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, eternal God, for you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged changings of times and seasons. You formed us in your own image and set us over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all that you have made, and forever praise you in your works through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels and saints, we join in that unending hymn of praise.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before he was given up to death, the death that he freely accepted, he took bread and said the blessing. He broke the bread, giving it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice again, giving you thanks and praise, giving it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, to be shed for you and for many for forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore,
as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, this life-giving bread, this saving chalice, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be here in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, may we be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Lord, remember your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Thomas, our Bishop, his assistant bishop, and all who serve your holy people. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep and the hope of resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. We pray for those who have died because of the COVID-19 virus and for all who have died during this period of other complications. As we move forward, may we never forget them, to know they are important to God and to us. Welcome them into the light of your presence. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that together with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, Joseph, her spouse, the apostles, and all the saints who have done your will throughout the ages, may we praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Let us pray as one family by the words that Jesus teaches us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And we think of others at this moment. If we're watching this Mass with someone next to us, we can offer them a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy.
For those of you watching Mass here for the very first time, you know it's sad that we can't literally eat the body and blood of Christ at this moment, at this celebration, this prayer to God. But we have what's called spiritual communion. It is a reminder that God is not limited by human nature in this giving grace. And so even though we can't receive here, God supersedes that and goes to whoever's watching right now, and that God is with you and offer you that grace. So your prayer means everything. And just be open to have your heart, as people here receive communion, to know that the spiritual communion, God's grace breaks through human nature. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for those who are attending communion Sunday, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. We've had great, great responses, and people have come. It's the safest way. Everyone's wearing masks, and it just takes a few moments to come and receive. You make it as sacred as you want. You take time to prepare and to pray afterwards and do acts of charity. And there's information on our website to guide you. And we're so glad. I'm there to give blessings, to talk to people, encourage, and I'm just honored to give blessings of anniversaries or people just needing, or if they're ill, I'm right there to help you there, and you'll see me there. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let the people say amen.
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 All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you.